Okay, so you talk in the Q&A about how much you love House by the Cemetery. It's one of my favorite Fulcis too.
When I was young, I couldn't even tell the difference between American movies and European movies. They were all just the same. Okay. And I just loved all horror. So for me, it wasn't that House by the Cemetery or The Beyond were Italian. They were just horror movies, and that's what I liked so much. And when I was younger, I was very obsessed with The Beyond and Zombie 2. Uh-huh. And it wasn't until much later that I even saw House by the Cemetery. I did not see it until I was probably close to 30. And I fell in love with it. I thought it was such a cool, strange movie, even for Fulci, because it has such a linear plot. It actually, unlike a lot of his other films that kind of have this weird dreamlike state, it's a story, and it's a straightforward story about these people moving to this house, and there's something awful in the basement, but it has all those flourishes of his that I grew up loving placed in. There are those surreal moments, and there are those things that don't make any sense, and it still has a crazy ending, you know, where they just walk off into the white, you know? And I love that. I think it's so gorgeous and creepy and beautiful. And I've just always really loved that aesthetic. And so when I was thinking about what to do, the idea was like, well, I want to do something like House by the Cemetery. And a friend of mine suggested writing a homage to it. We kept the basic idea of a family moving into an old house in New England, and that there's something very dark and ancient in the basement. But beyond that, we kind of just took it in our own direction. And we bumped up the Fulci, the Fulci moments. I think there are more Fulci moments in my movie than there are in House by the Cemetery, because I wanted to overdo it. And, you know, there's a lot more Lovecraft in my movie, like things that I just wanted to put into it. And, yeah, the movies that I've written and produced over the years are more exploitation-style films. It's like slashers, like lots of gore, lots of nudity. And I wanted this movie to be very different from those. For my first film to be something that felt a little more mature. I did not want to start with, and I love immature movies, like I adore them.
Yeah.
But I thought if I only ever get to make one movie as director, I want it to be a smart, mature movie. And movie number two can be the gory, nudity, crazy, because I love that stuff. I just felt like I should probably prove myself immediately if I want to keep doing this.
Yeah, I agree with you about House by the Cemetery, because when I watch it, it's like, oh my god, it's not the regular Fulci movie, like City of the Living Dead, for example.
Yeah, yeah.
It's too crazy, you know?
Right.
And I love the Dr. Freudstein.
Yeah, Dr. Freudstein.
I was expecting for some Dr. Freudstein in your movie too, but you put Jacob, right?
Oh yeah, yeah. Well, and May is his wife. And so yeah, that was as close as I could get to the, because I thought the last name Freudstein was so ridiculous.
Yeah, yeah.
Even in when they made House by the Cemetery, it's such a ridiculous name that I did not think I could put it in the movie straight-faced. There was just no way. But, you know, the main couple, you know, Anne and Paul are, you know, named after Anya Peroni and Paolo Marco. And then their last name, Sacchetti, is Dardano Sacchetti. So all of their names come from some part of House by the Cemetery.
And Dave and Kat are because of David Warbeck and Kat Yarmakov, or it's a coincidence?
Kat is named after Katrina McCall. Uh-huh. Dave is not. Dave is the one name in the movie that I took from another film. Mm-hmm. There is an 80s exploitation movie that is one of my favorite movies of all time called Sorority Babes in the Slimeball Bowl-O-Rama.
Dave DeCoteau.
Yes, it's a Dave DeCoteau movie, yes. And in that movie, they always speak about the legendary bowler, Dave McCabe.
Dave McCabe,
So he's named after the legendary bowler in that film.
Right.
So, and that was just kind of
the
funny...
The guy is Dave McCabe in your movie, too.
Dave McCabe. But Kat, his wife, is totally named after Katrina McCall.
Yeah.
And the Dagmars are named after Dagmar Lysander.
And Bobby, because of that annoying...
The annoying kid. Little Bobby, yeah. So, I hate that kid.
This is very good, because to regular people, you know, they don't care about this. But to people who know the movie, it's like an Easter egg, you know.
Very
funny.
You know, those are a lot of the Fulci references, but, you know, there are lots of hidden Lovecraft references in the film as well.
Yeah.
You know, early on, Dave is telling the story about what happened to the Dagmars, and he says, oh, Dagmar was selling corpses to the university over in Essex County, and that's Miskatonic University.
Yeah.
So it's really basically, he made up a story that Dagmar was selling corpses to Herbert West.
Yeah.
So, and I wanted to put a reference to Miskatonic University, but I didn't want to say it, because I thought that was too on the nose. But yeah, it's always famously known as the university in Essex County, so we put that in. Yeah.
And to me, a very great thing about the movie is that you talked about in the Q&A adult characters.
Yeah.
It's very difficult to saw this in the horror scene right now.
Yeah.
Because they are making movies to teenagers.
You know? Yeah, but I feel like you don't have to cast teenagers if you're making a movie for teenagers. Because when I fell in love with horror movies, I was never paying attention to the age of the people in it. I just loved it was a horror movie. You know, like, I loved The Changeling, even though George C. Scott is 54 in that movie. And I was watching that movie when I was 10, and I never thought that was odd. I just liked it because it was a good horror movie. But, yeah, my hope is that my film will still appeal to young horror fans because it's a cool horror movie, not because of the age of the characters. You know, I think a good example of that actually is Rob Zombie's The Devil's Rejects. You know, a film where virtually everyone in that film is in their 40s, 50s, or 60s, but young horror audiences completely embraced that film, you know, and they love it. And there's no young teen star in that movie. It's just a cool movie, and people love it because of that. So, I mean, that was kind of the hope with my movie, was just that people would like it because it's fun and gory and it has cool ghosts in it. And it doesn't matter that the youngest main character is 52, you know?
Yeah.
And even the fact that, you know, the antagonist in the film, Dave, I mean, he's 82. You know, it's so rare that you would ever see anything like that in any movie. But again, you know, we wanted to have this huge variation in age. There's actually a moment late in the movie where Paul says to Dave, he says, "Fuck you, old man." And it's in that way that he's 35 years older than Paul. So
What's the most challenging thing about directing your first movie?
Directing this movie, it was a really amazing opportunity. Mm-hmm. And I did not actually have a lot of huge challenges.
But are you scared?
I was terrified. Oh yeah, completely. Like, beyond terrified. I was scared because it was my first film. And because my cast had worked with such amazing directors before. You know, it's like Barbara, you know, has worked with Stuart Gordon, and, you know, Paul has, you know, he was the star of Upstream Color, you know, that Shane Carruth directed.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, Lisa worked with Tim Burton, you know, and Larry's worked with Martin Scorsese. You know, and Monty was the star of a William Castle movie. Like, he was directed by William Castle. And so when I show up, it's very scary to think, like, all these people have been directed by, like, some of the greatest directors.
A lot of background.
Yeah, like, how am I possibly going to live up to that? But I feel like very early on, within the first day, all of that fear went away, because I just realized that they were all very excited to be there, and they were all very happy to be there, and they just wanted to make a movie, you know, and they respected me, and they believed in me, and it worked. So, I hope.
And when I talked to Adrian before, we are speaking about this generation that was educated by video stores.
Yeah.
Do you think that the video era was important to directors like you?
I mean, I think it was hugely important to me. I mean, I assume it was to you too, like video stores. Mm-hmm. For me, now it's so easy to see any movie ever made, you know, you can just find it on the internet, you know, through legal means or illegal means, that every movie ever is there. And for me, I remember reading books about horror movies, like rare horror movies, and I would become obsessed with trying to find them, and I would go to all these video stores. And I grew up in rural Montana, like in the middle of nowhere. And the town I lived in had 3 video stores, and one was a Blockbuster. So it didn't have anything special. But the other 2 video stores I would go into, and I would bring a list, like a handwritten list, and I would say, like, can you find these movies? And, you know, sometimes they would order them for the store because I would ask for them. Mm-hmm. And every time my family went on vacation, I was obsessed. I would tell my parents, I was like, we have to go to every video store in town. And my parents were like, oh God, like another fucking video store.
Yeah.
And I would become so obsessed that I would arrive at a new video store and I would just ask my parents to leave me there all day. And I would spend like 3 or 4 or 5 hours just sitting there looking at every videotape and reading the back and reading the cast and seeing if it was from a director that I knew, because it's before the internet. So it was exciting. I remember finding Deadly Friend at a video store. But I didn't know that because it was before that time. And I remember picking it up and going, what's this? And I read the whole back and I went, oh, this is interesting. And then I read and it said written and directed by Wes Craven. And I felt like I had found like the Holy Grail. Like, I had no idea that this movie wasn't rare or anything, but I had never heard of it before. I'd never seen it before. All I knew Wes Craven from were the 4 movies that I knew of at that time. And I remember like begging my parents, I was like, I need to buy this, I need to buy this. And they were like, okay, you can buy it. And I brought it home and, you know, like I would sit it proudly up to show all my friends this special rare tape. Even though it wasn't rare at all, it just wasn't in Great Falls, Montana. But I feel like because of that, I have a lot more respect for genre films because they were more special. They were these important things that not everyone could get. And if you really wanted to know about them, you had to go out of your way. You had to become scholarly. Mm-hmm. Now with the internet and with all these books, I mean, you can go on Amazon.com and look up Lucio Fulci, and there are like 20 books on Lucio Fulci. Like, in 1988, there were no books on Lucio Fulci, and there was no internet. So all I knew was that there was this man who I think I called like Luckio, because I didn't even know how to pronounce his name. And it blew my mind when I realized that these Italian directors were using different names. So then I would realize like 2 movies I owned were directed by Dario Argento, but they say by David Silver,
you know,
and I had no idea that, you know, that this was a thing.
And Jess Franco.
Yeah, of course. 200 different names. Yeah. Probably half my collection was directed by Jess Franco, and I didn't know. So, but yeah, no, I think that that sort of scavenger hunt feeling of the VHS day, like, it created very scholarly, respectful genre fans that I don't know if we're going to have anymore.
Yeah.
You know, like, I hope we do. I hope people will still study these movies, because I always say, like, I love slasher movies and I love exploitation movies, but I do not love them ironically.
Yeah.
You know, like that movie I mentioned, Sorority Babes and the Slimeball Bowlerama. I love that movie. Like, I don't love it because I think it's a bad movie. I love it because I love it. You know, and it's the sort of film that I show to people and they go, oh, okay, it's going to be bad. And by the time it's over, they go, that was really fun. Yeah. It's like, yeah, like, exactly. Like, I feel like we are also now living in an age with this culture where it's okay for, like, to make fun of things more. And I don't like that. There was a great article in Los Angeles about a screening of Hercules and the Haunted World.
Okay.
And that everyone at that screening was, like, laughing hysterically. And there were all these people who were like, fuck, I actually wanted to go watch this. I wanted to go see this print of this movie. And no one here is taking it seriously.
No respect.
I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad... There are different ways to look at it, because no one will ever argue that Hercules and the Haunted World is a very deep, moving film. It's not. It's rather silly.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like I've laughed when I watched that movie before, but I also would not like to watch it with a room full of people making fun of it. So there, you know, I think there are different levels of respect to films. You know, like, I laugh, I chuckle when I watch a Lucio Fulci movie. Like, you know, I laugh when I watch, you know, even great Italian horror or American horror. The moment at the end of Tenebrae, mm-hmm. when she gets her arm chopped off
and then
walks around the room as it sprays everywhere, that always makes me laugh.
Yeah.
But it's not because it's cheesy.
Mm-hmm.
It's not because it looks fake. I laugh because it's a nervous laughter, because it's such an amazing, insane moment that I want to laugh because it makes me happy that something is that crazy. I don't want to show that movie to someone and have them point and go, oh, it looks so stupid, it looks so stupid. It's like, fuck, no, like, then this is not for you.
Yeah.
So.
And what's the most difficult aspect in the making of the movie? Is, like, the recreation of the time, the 79? Or it was the balance of scares, the jump scares, and the bloodier stuff?
I think the most trying aspect of the production was the temperature. Like, it was so cold that...
Because of this, right now you don't have cold anymore.
Yeah, no, I'm not cold ever again. I will never be cold again after making that movie. The entire time that we were there, it never got above freezing, ever. It actually never got close to freezing. Like, it was so far below freezing that we never worried about the snow going away. And the house itself is so old that the only heat in the entire house were those two small stoves that you see in the film, the two little ovens. They were the only heat. So when we would call cut, everyone would race into those rooms to stay warm. The house was never freezing, but it was uncomfortably cold all the time. So that was very difficult. I think it was the best thing that we got out of the cold, though, were the special effects, because it's much easier to maintain good special effects in the cold. They won't droop or sag.
Yeah.
The cold keeps them nice.
Or melt.
Yeah, it keeps them, like, nice and hard. So the gore, we could set up a good gore gag and not worry about having to do it in 10 seconds before it falls apart.
Okay.
The cold would keep things together.
Yeah.
So that's the silver lining to freezing.
Okay. I have to ask you, do you look for the old house by the cemetery?
Have I ever...
The real house.
Oh, I know where it is.
Yeah,
absolutely. It's right outside of Boston. And I originally thought about shooting the movie there. But when I visited it, it has changed so much. Yeah. It has very ugly metal siding on it. And it is now an artist's commune. A group of artists live there, and they paint and make music. And it's cool, but it would have been very difficult to shoot there. Mm-hmm. Also, a lot of House by the Cemetery was shot in different locations, exterior and the interior. Yeah. They actually built several of the sets. Some of the larger sets were built.
And the basement, of course. Yeah.
And the basement, yes. Whereas I feel very lucky that all the house that we filmed in, it came with that amazing basement, so which was incredible. The basement was extremely cold too, but we were pretending that it was hot in the movie, which was very difficult because you could see everyone's breath. So we would have to do that old trick where the actor would hold ice in their mouth up until right before you would call action, and you'd spit out the ice, and your mouth is so cold that it does not make the breath visible.
Okay. To finish.
Yeah, sure.
Can you talk a little about the directors that you like, besides Stuart Gordon and Fulci?
Yeah.
And the movies that you like, you prefer Italian, you prefer old American, old school American horror?
I am a big fan of 70s and 80s Italian cinema.
Yeah.
I really love 80s American cinema.
Yeah.
I quite love 70s and 90s Japanese cinema.
Okay.
Genre cinema, with a few exceptions. There are a few great 80s films from Japan. But I think my heart is in old school American 80s slashers. I really fell in love with a lot of those movies, from the great to the terrible. I have a lot of love for all of them. I love Carpenter up until 86. I love a lot of Wes Craven stuff. I still think Wes Craven occasionally makes something good. I really like Red Eye a lot. I think that's the last good thing he made. Mm-hmm. I really like Kieran Foy. I loved Citadel, Scottish, I believe. I think he's Irish, but I believe the film was shot in Scotland. And he's directing Sinister 2 now, which I'm excited to see. Just because I liked Citadel so much, I'm curious what he will do with it. Who else? I think I'm sure there are others out there. I'm friends with a lot of modern filmmakers that I really like a lot. You know, I would say it even if Adrian was not around, but I like what he's doing. I was very happy to work, on Cheap Thrills for Evan Katz. I was the publicist for that movie. I think he's an amazingly talented new voice, in genre film, and I'm very excited to see what he does next. I really like The Innkeepers a lot, Ty West's The Innkeepers, which again, I worked on that film. So I feel very fortunate that I know personally a lot of filmmakers that I think are some of the best working in the genre today.